Now, most royal experts think the reign of Britain's King Charles III has gotten off to a good start. Charles became king less than a year ago, following the death of his mother, Queen Elizabeth. But even prior to becoming king, Charles already had a track record of green initiatives. And some members of the public hope he continues to work he did with his charity.
Well, I think actually we're all quite surprised at how well King Charles has begun. I mean, it was bad luck that no sooner did he begin when his own son, you know, started throwing bombs and hand grenades. But, you know, he did an amazing job, I thought, the week of the Queen's death. He really did. He had one gaffe where he made the silly video, whatever. But basically, he did things with stature, with composure, with humanity. And I do think that his authentic passion for the environment, his commitment to pursue every single remedy we can against climate change, his, you know, passion for organic farming, all the things that he was mocked for as a young Prince of Wales, you know, have completely come full circle, and he is now seen as the sort of grandfather of this current almost movement.
To further build up excitement for the ceremony, a giant bejeweled crown is on display in London. The 16-foot tall installation is a replica of the St. Edward's crown, filled with over 30 different colored glass stones.
I'm so excited to this weekend, this coronation, and we have so beautiful things like that, and London is more beautiful this weekend, so we're gonna, I can't wait for next 2 days.
We're just a day away from the historic coronation of King Charles III. Our correspondent Katrina Domingo is in London to give us the latest. Kat, over to you.
Hi, Stanley. All eyes now on London as the coronation of King Charles III draws closer today. Now, there are three things Filipinos here are keeping close tabs on. First, the coronation itself, which will be happening for the first time in 70 years here in the United Kingdom. Second is the arrival of Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., who is among the list or who is among the VIP guests of the coronation. He is expected to arrive today, and he is also expected to participate in the pre-coronation gathering at the Buckingham Palace, a reception for royalties from different parts of the world, as well as for heads of states who were also invited to the coronation of the new king. Now, aside from that, Stanley, Filipinos also keeping a close tab on Marcos Jr.'s meeting with British Prime Minister Rishi Sunak. The president earlier said that it will just happen on the sidelines of the coronation itself, as his schedule here in London is pretty tight, given that he needs to rush back to the Philippines to make it in time to Indonesia for the ASEAN summit next week. Here's what President Marcos had to say.
So very casual lang ito, very informal. Pero wag natin mamalitin yung mga ganyang klaseng meeting. Dahil kuminsan, yung hindi mo inaakalain mangyayari, may nangyayari na napaka-importante pala. Makikipagkita ako sa kanilang bagong Prime Minister, Prime Minister Sunak, upang makapag-usap kami kung merong bang pagbabago sa kanyang pag-iisip sa pag-partner ng UK at saka ng Pilipinas. Sa palagay ko ay ganun din ang sasabihin niya na dapat ipapatibayin natin at naghihingalo, hirap na hirap ang ekonomiya ng UK. So baka isang bagay yun na pag-uusapan namin kung paano mag-trade o kung paano dagdagan, isa sa lahat, I'm sure, babanggitin niya kung pwedeng makakuha ng healthcare workers galing Pilipinas, dadalhin sa UK. In general, we will maintain the same relationship. It has been a very a relationship very advantageous to all parties involved. So I think that we will stay the course.
The president there saying how important economic ties between Manila and London will be in the coming years, especially after the post-COVID-19 pandemic. But just to give viewers a context here, the United Kingdom is one of the Philippines' largest trading partners here in the European region, while the Philippines is the UK's 64th largest trading partner, with total trade between the two countries amounting to 2.4 billion pounds as of 2022. Total UK exports to the Philippines is pegged at 1.2 billion pounds in 2022 alone, while their imports from the Philippines is also pegged at 1.2 billion pounds that same year. Now, so far, Stanley, we have been trying to ask the embassy on what time the president will exactly arrive here, where he will be staying, and if ever there will be a chance for the media to ask him several questions with regard to his visit here in London. But the embassy has yet to release such details, citing security reasons for the president. Stanley.
All right, Katrina Domingo, we look forward to hearing more from you. Another shooting rocks Serbia. A gunman killed 8 people and wounded 13 others in a drive-by attack in the village of Dubona late Thursday. That's the second such mass killing in the Balkan country in 2 days. Police say the 21-year-old gunman remains at large, but they have already cordoned off the area where the suspect may be hiding. This comes a day after a 13-year-old boy opened fire on his classmates at a school in Serbia's capital, Belgrade. At least 8 children and a security guard were killed in that attack. A Sudanese envoy insists the country's army is ready to cease fighting immediately. But according to him, that's only if the rival paramilitary rapid support forces lay down arms first. The two sides appear to be battling for control of territory in the capital Khartoum ahead of proposed talks. Leaders of both factions, however, have shown little willingness to negotiate after more than 2 weeks of fighting.
We are willing to stop the fighting immediately after we put an end to that fighting, because the government of Sudan did not start that fighting. The other party, the other rebellion, I would say, are still raising up arms, fighting, and they didn't show any consent to yield or to give up. And we have announced more than one time that there is still a chance to pardon whoever is ready to put down arms.
In the NBA playoffs, the Golden State Warriors turned Game 2 of their second round series against the Los Angeles Lakers into a laugher. After trailing by 7 points at the end of the first quarter, the Dubs unleashed 84 points in the middle quarters to take full control. Klay Thompson drilled 8 three-pointers to pace the Warriors with 30 points. The victory leveled the best-of-7 series at a game apiece. The series now shifts to Los Angeles for the next 2 games. A jury sides with Ed Sheeran in the copyright infringement lawsuit involving his hit song, Thinking Out Loud. The jury decided that Sheeran did not plagiarize Marvin Gaye's classic 1973 song, Let's Get It On. The verdict came after 6 days of trial and less than 3 hours of deliberations. The heirs of Let's Get It On songwriter Ed Townsend sued the British singer-songwriter in 2017, claiming Thinking Out Loud copied the heart of Gaye's song, including its melody, harmony, and rhythm.
I'm very grateful that the jury saw through those attempts. This seems so dangerous to me. Both potential claimants who may be convinced to bring a bogus claim, as well as those songwriters facing them. It's simply wrong. By stopping this practice, we can also properly support genuine music copyright claims so legitimate claims are rightly heard and resolved. If the jury had decided this matter the other way, we might as well say goodbye to the creative freedom of songwriters. We need to be able to write our original music and engage in independent creation without worrying at every step of the way that such creativity will be wrongly called into question. Like artists everywhere,